prepared me beyond all expectations. As a junior at Auburn University, I approached my studies with great confidence thanks to what I learned at OMA. When I think back on my time on the mountain, I think of my teachers. Their genuine love and concern for me as a student was always evident. And now, as an adult, I still foster those relationships. I'm Carly Robinson, an Oak Mountain Academy alum. Visit oakmountain.us to see how you can offer your child an amazing opportunity to be a warrior.
For more than 70 years, you have turned to Tanner Health System for your healthcare needs. As our community moves forward, Tanner is here for you. Strong, safe, and close to home. Routine medical appointments, urgent elective surgeries, and imaging are back on the calendar at our hospitals and Tanner Medical Group practices. With the safety of our patients, staff, and community always our top priority. Learn more at Tanner.org. Hashtag We Are Tanner Strong. That's Tanner.org. Hashtag We Are Tanner Strong.
National headlines and the local stories you care about. WLBB, Carrollton, News Talk, 1330, FM 106.3.
And good morning. Welcome to Community Voice. I am your host, Josh Engel. It is a crisp and cool December 2nd morning out there. Thank you for tuning into Community Voice. Today we have a very special guest from Tanner Health Systems, Dr. Anil Dhople, Radiation Oncology Quality Advisor with Tanner Healthcare. We're going to be talking about lung cancer screening and treatment. It's something, as we will discuss, which has been a problem in Georgia, well, in the country at large, but in Georgia especially. And it's something that has affected the lives of millions, and it's very scary. It is very dangerous, but I think that Dr. Dhople is going to help make it seem a little less scary. But first and foremost, good morning, Dr. Dhople. How are you?
Good morning, Josh. It's good to be here. Thanks for inviting me. My first radio show, so I hope I do well for you guys.
Well, you're already doing great because you praised us, which is nice, so that makes us feel good. So thank you so much for joining us. It is his first time here in the program, and we're going to be talking about some heavy subjects, but I know that it's going to go great. So first and foremost, tell us a little bit about you, about your credentials. Tell us about you.
Sure. I actually just joined Tanner Health System a couple weeks ago. I was previously practicing in Melbourne, Florida. I had been down at that job for about 11 years. And in fact, I was practicing medicine in my hometown. I had been previously to that. I was in the academic setting at the University of Maryland as an assistant professor, taking care of patients and teaching residents. It's also where I had done my residency in radiation oncology. So I thought I was going to stay there for quite a long time, but then when you start a family and you realize, gosh, it would be nice to be a little closer to your parents. And
things change.
So after our first kid was born, Amira, we were still there for about a year and a half. And then Elena, the littler one, was on her way. So we decided to start looking for a job closer to home. And we ended up taking a job at where I was raised. And really, that's how I was practicing for 11 years. I decided around that time, about a year and a half ago, that after being board certified and taking care of patients, I wanted to take that next step and kind of be a leader of a radiation department. And so that's really what I was looking for. We looked around and Carrollton really surprised me. So where I was a very small town, and I enjoyed that. I enjoyed being in a community where I could be in the grocery store and run into patients. And Carrollton also is like that. But what really surprised me was all the technology that is available at Tanner Health System, particularly in our radiation oncology department. So for that reason, I mean, I came up here. It's been great.
So you would say the Tanner Health System is above average in terms of their technology?
Absolutely. There's technology here that I actually didn't have access to in Florida. And I was practicing on the space coast of Florida where all the rockets launch.
Wow.
So we have some technology that's available that Elon Musk doesn't have available to him.
How paradoxical. It's like 50 yards away, they're launching into space. And
right.
Yeah. Well, that's a testament to how great Tanner is. And we're very thankful to have it and then that technology because it serves the community very well.
Well, and there's a whole team of people that already are at Tanner. And those people are actually vital to implementing the technology. So from the moment you walk in the door to the moment you walk out of the door, there's a whole team of people that are taking care of you. And that team existed before I got here. And so it's just been a real pleasure to be able to work with them and get things running the way I see going forward.
Sure. So in the short time that you've been here, how has your experience been?
Oh, it's been fantastic. Everybody, not just in my department, but in the other departments of the hospital administration, and then just the community in general has been fantastic. Just calling, honestly, calling Spectrum was actually a pleasure here than it's ever been anywhere else I've been. It really wasn't a problem to get what I needed done. Everything's new to me here. So I have to find banking. I have to, figure out where I'm going to do athletic events. And even the school systems have been great. So I can't tell you this. I can't be more happy with the way things are going.
That's awesome. I'm so glad to hear that. My experience was very similar when I moved here from Athens. Honestly, I really fell in love with the community, and with the exception of looking for athletic events, because clearly I'm not doing that. With the exception of that, everything else is pretty much the same. I like that small town feel, and I love how people want to talk to each other and want to get to know each other. So let's talk about lung cancer. From your experience, how dangerous truly is lung cancer?
So the problem with lung cancer is that people don't really get symptoms from early stage lung cancer, and your lungs don't have sensation to it. So you can have something growing in your lung for quite a long time and it won't cause a symptom. And by the time you get a symptom, often it has already become more advanced stage. And so that's the scary part about lung cancer. We never really had good ways of identifying it early enough. And so when cancer of the lungs spreads to or becomes more advanced and spreads to other parts of the body, it can oftentimes already be incurable. And so we're already behind the eight ball, so to speak.
Now, so in terms of, that is terrifying. And I've thought of that before. I've wondered if, there aren't necessarily nerves, right? I mean, there are, but in the lungs, like you would have on your skin, where you can tell something's happening or where you can feel something. What are numbers like in Georgia?
So, the number of new lung cancers per year, I think some of the most recent numbers in the United States was 230,000 people get diagnosed with lung cancer every year. That's a huge, almost 250,000 people every year are getting diagnosed. Now, the reality is that you might have 250,000 people getting diagnosed with breast cancer or prostate cancer, which are very common. And we talk a lot about those cancers. The death rate, though, from lung cancer is also quite high. And that's the scary part. So last year, 136,000 people actually died of lung cancer. So those numbers are actually quite high. If we go through some statistics of it, out of 100,000 people getting diagnosed in the United States, 55 of them are going to be diagnosed with lung cancer. And in Georgia, it's actually a little bit higher. It's almost 60 out of every 100,000 people get diagnosed with lung cancer. So it's a little bit higher than the national average. You can hypothesize all sorts of different reasons why it might be a little higher in Georgia. It could be that maybe there's more smokers that live in Georgia compared to the national average. These details I don't know yet, but...
Well, I was wondering about the textile industry.
Sure.
There's a lot of carcinogens that come from the textile industry up in North Georgia. There have been, birth defects and increase in suicide rates. I mean, it's all very suspicious, and I've wondered if that had anything to do with it. Of course, it's pure speculation, but...
There are definitely some environmental causes as well. That's why we have radon gas detectors and things like that. There are chemicals in some of the materials that you might be talking about that may be carcinogens. And so, personal protection is also very important for people who have to work in those industries. But I think for me, when you ask how dangerous or how concerned, I think the biggest thing we can do as a society is to get people to stop smoking. And we've done a good job. It can be better. And what scares me a little bit more is the unknown effects of vaping. So there's this thought that, it's vapor, it's not as bad, but it's still going in your lungs, getting trapped. And we'll see. I advise patients not to go from smoking to vaping. I don't think it's any safer.
Sure. And that's important information. So we're going to take our first break. When we come back, we're going to continue our conversation with Dr. Anil Dhople, a lung, the Radiation Oncology Quality Advisor with Tanner Health System. So stay with us.
At Oak Mountain Academy, our daily schedule includes convocation, prayer, and the Pledge of Allegiance. By doing so, we build a family-like community where all students grow and flourish and personal faith is encouraged. Through community service and a historical approach to biblical study, our students are taught the value of the warrior way, honesty, respect, and responsibility. Oak Mountain Academy, we are a family creating legacies. To learn more, visit oakmountain.us.
For more than 70 years, you have turned to Tanner Health System for your healthcare needs. As our community moves forward, Tanner is here for you. Strong, safe, and close to home. Routine medical appointments, urgent elective surgeries, and imaging are back on the calendar at our hospitals and Tanner Medical Group practices. With the safety of our patients, staff, and community always our top priority. Learn more at Tanner.org. Hashtag We Are Tanner Strong. That's Tanner.org. Hashtag We Are Tanner Strong.
And good morning. We're back to Community Voice. I'm your host, Josh Engel. If you're just tuning in, be sure to hop over to Facebook. If you're sitting at your desk at work or something, tune in to the Facebook live stream. We have Dr. Anil Dhople with us this morning, Radiation Oncology Quality Advisor over at Tanner Healthcare, and we're talking about lung cancer. So if you have any questions, feel free to throw them out here. We do have a few comments that have popped on. Debbie Godby Bolding, excited to have Dr. Dhople on board at Tanner. You already got fans. And we have a question here from Anita Wilson. How accurate is the test? So that actually brings us into our next topic here. Let's talk about the history of screening for lung cancer and early detection.
Yeah, so one of the important parts about understanding screening is not trying to take care of the patient who's already developed the symptom. We worry about the patient that has a symptom, so we're going to do more diagnostic testing up front. Screening really applies to the people that are high risk for harboring a lung cancer but have absolutely no symptoms. So people at big risk are going to be active smokers between the ages of 55 and 74, or somebody who quit smoking within the last 15 years and has no symptoms. We need to keep a close eye on those patients. And you know, the reason we want to screen is early stage lung cancer. If you can catch lung cancer at stage one, small cancer centered in the lung, hasn't spread to any of the lymph nodes or other parts of the body, that's a curable cancer. You can have cure rates upwards of 80 to 85%.
Really?
Stage one lung cancer.
I did not know that.
Yeah. So when people say, oh, why did you get involved? It's such a sad field to go and treat. Well, the reality is, if we make improvements on screening, we cure more people. And that really is... It's so uplifting to have a patient come back who's made it 5 years after a stage one lung cancer and they're free and clear. Now, I beat my head against the wall when they say they still smoke.
Oh my,
so we got to make...
They still smoke.
Well, we have some patients to do. Some patients, the diagnosis scares the bejeebies out of them and they stop instantaneously.
I used to smoke and I quit about 5 years ago. And the reason that I quit finally is because my wife mentioned she knew someone... in her apartment complex, he was like 20 years old, and he had a grapefruit-sized tumor in his lungs from smoking. And I was like, all right, well, that sounds terrible, so I'm not going to do that anymore. But I definitely, you know, I didn't want to pick it back up after that because it's scary.
So screening kind of started decades ago when we were doing chest x-rays for everybody. Oh, just go get a chest x-ray. And a lot of chest x-rays were being done on a lot of people, and you can't really get a good picture with a chest x-ray alone. And so it's a two-dimensional picture. You're looking at shadows. It's a film, and it's hard to see. And if you do have an abnormality on a chest x-ray, the next natural step was to go to a CT scan to get more detail. So a CT scan gives you a three-dimensional picture of the inside of your body. Well, the doctors, researchers started asking the question, well, why not just skip the chest x-ray and start screening people with the CT scan? Decades ago, the amount of radiation that was associated with the CT scan was actually quite high compared to where we are now. They have low radiation exposure CT scans, and that is the new technology that's used to screen for lung cancer. And it gives a much more accurate picture to the radiologist and there's criteria based on the size of the nodule, whether it's likely to be malignant, cancerous, or not. And there's a whole series of protocols that the radiologist will follow based on the size of the lesion and whether it goes and gets a biopsy or wait and observe it. So it's a difficult thing to tell you exactly, for Anita Wilson's question, what is the accuracy of it? Because it really depends on what size they find the spot in the lung. But if you find a spot in the lung, and it's only in one part, that is potentially a stage one lung cancer and is curable.
So what would be, let's say someone were to be, they would qualify for screening and they came to you. Would you mind taking us through the process of what necessarily that screening entails? You've spoke a bit about the technical side of it. If you were a patient, what would their experience be like now?
So it's really quite simple. Tanner Health System has you can talk to your primary care provider about getting screened through the Tanner program, but you can it's just a phone call that you make. The process though is quite simple. You go in, you lay on a table, you zip in and zip out of a CT scanner. There's no contrast given, so there's no potential for allergic reactions. There's no IVs. You lay on a table, you go in a donut and out of a donut, and it's pretty quick. Usually within a day or two later, a radiologist has read the scan and looked at it and said whether they found something or didn't find something. Again, I kind of alluded to, based if they did find something and it's very small, they might just watch it for another couple months and do another scan. If it's big enough and it's suspicious, they'll send you for a biopsy. They'll call your doctor and say, we found this spot and needs a biopsy. And Tanner's got a wonderful program. If there's a suspicion for cancer, they have a 3-day referral program. And many doctors utilize that just to get the ball rolling so we can get diagnoses quicker on patients instead of waiting weeks and weeks to get in to see specialists.
What are risk factors?
Well, I've talked a little bit about smoking being the big one. I mean, to me, that is your biggest risk factor for developing a lung cancer. There are certainly environmental issues if you lived with a smoker. So, you know, kids know not to smoke, but their parents were smoking for their whole life, and that's a big risk factor for lung cancer. There's a family history component to it a little bit. Parent had it, grandparent had it. There may be some genetic components to it. Other environmental factors, radiation coming from the rocks in the ground. So we want radon detectors in people's houses, or if you live in those parts of the country where it's prevalent. I alluded to earlier also about vaping. I'm not sure. I don't think it's been around long enough to make sort of big judgments. But to me, anything that you're inhaling into your lungs can't be good.
And as you mentioned, it's still a relatively new development. I would imagine there would need to be years of peer-reviewed research that would go into that particular, into vaping to see just how dangerous it was.
Correct. And, you know, it took a long time for our society to recognize smoking as a big risk factor because there's big lobbying groups that prevented us from having that research published. So, you know, it's a different day and age. But again, my advice to anybody is, man, just don't stick anything in your lungs.
It is trippy to go back and watch like old episodes of The Twilight Zone and you see like Rod Serling be like, the Chesterfield, the safer cigarette, you know, and they're
right.
Holding it. You're like, all right, it's like a doctor holding it. You're like, they were really pumping money into the entertainment industry to make that seem safe, but it's not. It's horribly dangerous.
We were traveling a couple years ago in India. My family's from India and my kids were born here and I was born here, but we went to India for the first time in like 25 years. And it's amazing when you see the cigarette packages. Instead of it just having a warning, it shows a picture of lung cancer, or it shows a picture of a person who has died of lung cancer. It shows a picture of, it is graphic.
Wow.
And that, if that doesn't get you to not pick up that pack of cigarettes and drop your money down, I don't know. But we don't have that here. It was amazing to see these pictures.
That's so effective. But it's honest, too. And I appreciate that. I appreciate that they're like, look, you can do what you want, but this is what's going to happen. It's not like, people want to cite someone like George Burns. They puff
That's
on
right.
cigars, but I mean, there's no telling what he had going on. I mean, it's dangerous.
That's right.
Now, in terms of in terms of who should get screened, Is there a particular, you mentioned earlier there's like a specific age range. What's the reasoning behind that age range and who should be getting screened?
So I think a lot of it comes down to when you look at the age range of people, you start doing some calculations about, well, how long were they smoking? How long does it take for the carcinogens to slowly have impact DNA changes with it on the cellular level to then lead to cancer? How long those cancers take to grow, develop, and show up on a scan? You know, if you look, a majority of people who are diagnosed for lung cancer, it's between the ages of 50s and 80s. So I think that's why the age range is there. You know, I think if there was a 44-year-old who rolled into the office saying that they've been smoking since they were 20, I don't think any doctor would have hesitation of doing a lung cancer screening on them. But the reality is, I mean, a lot of people aren't smoking from that young of an age or that much at a time. People who stopped smoking within the last 15 years, there's, you know, again, a range. If somebody stopped smoking 16 years ago, I still think we could figure out, we would suggest that they get screened.
So clearly it's, as you mentioned, even if someone is early or younger, that they could still be a potential that they have lung cancer. But just the averages, a lot of times you see older folks that have been smoking for a long time.
Correct.
And before we go to our next break, I'd like to ask, what are some warning signs? Let's say, you know, if I'm, you know, John Q. Public and I'm walking around, what should I pay attention to? And I'm not trying to get folks over paranoid, you know, like when you Google illnesses or something, but like,
right.
If I, you know, I was a former smoker, I've been clean for a pretty good long time, I think, but you know, I haven't touched it, but I mean, what should I be looking out for if I were a former smoker or something?
Yeah. And now this is looking for symptoms. So we're not really screening you. We're going to talk about symptoms of lung cancer that you need to be worried about. You know, a cough that doesn't go away or is getting worse or is unusual for you. Again, living in COVID times, that's kind of tough right now. So
Amen.
We have a lot of things to be worried about. All of a sudden, the ER is going to have an uptick in the number of people showing up with a cough because of what I just said.
Sure.
Coughing up blood, that's a big one. Coughing up blood is not normal. That should not be done. So that should not be happening. So that should be checked out. Deep breathing. If you take a deep breath in and gosh, every time you do that, you got chest pain, I think that's something to take a look at. A lot of times we have family members that have unexplained weight loss. You go see mom or dad or grandpa and it's like, man, they're losing 5 pounds every time I see them. Weight loss unexplained is a big sign of a cancer, not just lung cancer. It could be any cancer, and unexplained weight loss really should be investigated.
And what causes the weight loss from the cancer?
You know, my standard answer is, well, I mean, your body is burning energy for helping a cancer grow, and maybe you're not taking enough nutrition. You know, there's things about cancers when they spread and start involving other organs where your metabolism may not be as what it used to be. But unexplained weight loss is a big warning sign.
Excellent. Well, we're going to take our second break, but when we come back, we're going to wrap up our conversation with Dr. Anil Dhople, Radiation Oncology Quality Advisor with Tanner Healthcare. So stay with us.
For more than 70 years, you have turned to Tanner Health System for your healthcare needs. As our community moves forward, Tanner is here for you. Strong, safe, and close to home. Routine medical appointments, urgent elective surgeries, and imaging are back on the calendar at our hospitals and Tanner Medical Group practices. With the safety of our patients, staff, and community always our top priority. Learn more at Tanner.org. Hashtag We Are Tanner Strong. That's Tanner.org. Hashtag We Are Tanner Strong.
At Oak Mountain Academy, our academic excellence shines through innovation and a personalized educational experience. Our pre-K 3 through 12th grade environment offers a family-oriented atmosphere. We are an independent school with faith-based values and an academy honor code. Our academic standards prepare our students for college and beyond. I'm Patrick Duran, headmaster, inviting you to visit us on the mountain or at oakmountain.us. Come see how our warriors are creating legacies.
And we're back to Community Voice. I'm your host, Josh Engel. We have a Dr. Anil Dhople here in the studio. We've been talking about lung cancer screening and treatment. He is the Radiation Oncology Quality Advisor over at Tanner Healthcare. Thank you to Tanner Healthcare for sponsoring this podcast and making it possible. So we're very proud to have Dr. Dhople here in the studio. So if you're just tuning in, be sure to check out either the podcast of this episode, which has been or will be uploaded to this station's website, as well as graticommunications.com, or you can also check out the Facebook live stream on our WLBB Facebook page. So we only have about 5 minutes left here, Dr. Dhople. Let's take a few minutes to talk about final thoughts.
Yeah, I think what I'd like to tell people is really, if you're a smoker, talk to your doctor about different ways that you can quit smoking. Really, it's a mental game between yourself. You just got to make that commitment and stop smoking. If you've had any of these qualifications for screening, go ahead and talk to your doctor and get in and talk about getting in for a screening CT scan. Like I try to describe, they're quite easy, simple, safe, fast. And I, what Tanner Health System has done is made it very easy. There's a phone number that you can call, 770-812-9721, to call and schedule your own screening. It can't be much easier. A lot of places, it feels like it can be a struggle to get in, to get the scan. And I think here with a phone number live to a human being who can get that arranged for you and coordinate things with your primary care doctor, I mean, Tanner's gone all out on this, and I'm very pleased with it.
Excellent. Now, what do you hope to see in the future of this field?
I know this sounds a little bit holistic, but I'd like to see myself put out of business. Wouldn't it be nice if I don't have to treat cancer? I mean, I know that seems a little altruistic. Maybe it'll happen, but there is so much happening in research of cancers today with the advent of immunotherapy using the body's own immune system to fight cancer. I mean, that was science fiction 30 years ago. People got on these national stages and talked about how we're going to let our own body fight cancer. We don't need chemotherapy drugs. Here we are in 2020, and immunotherapy, drugs that are not chemo, drugs that actually are activating your body's immune system, have shown to improve survival. And some of those studies were pioneered with lung cancer.
Wow.
So immunotherapy has almost become a standard of care at this point. In fact, I think it is a standard of care in the treatment of certain lung cancers. And the number of drugs, the number of immunotherapies that are becoming more available is increasing by the week, it seems like. My medical oncology colleagues, that's their field of expertise, of course. The technology of radiation has gotten better and better. You can actually treat a moving cancer now with the technology available on the machines. And some of that technology is actually available here at Tanner, and we'll be implementing that soon in the very near future. But honestly, I really would like to see the fact that I am treating less and less patients because we have less and less cancers coming our way.
I mean, and as a physician, I appreciate you saying that because it is refreshing, because it's folks forget sometimes that you guys work very hard and go to school for a very long time to save lives and to try to hopefully someday prevent the need for these scans or for any procedures. I mean, hopefully with immunotherapy and stuff, eventually that can be curbed.
Yeah, and I know we have just a couple minutes, but you know, the benefit of catching things with stage one diseases, we're curing the cancers at an early stage. We have the opportunity to cure people. So we may not ever get away from having cancer being diagnosed, but the technology that we have allows us to also cure stage one lung cancer without even using surgery sometimes. And so that's pretty important too, because a lot of our patients who are in their late 50s, 60s, 70s, they may have other medical conditions that prevent them from having surgery. And so we have tools and technology that allows us to cure lung cancer without cutting them open.
All right. Well, before we wrap up, one more time, that phone number, and where can folks learn more?
Yeah. So the phone number to either you can have your doctor call or you can call yourself is 770-812-9721, and those screenings can be scheduled in Carrollton, Villarica, Bremen, or even Wedowee.
Excellent. Not too bad for your first Community Voice show, huh?
No, this was fun. I mean, I wouldn't mind coming back. You guys are a good crew.
Well, thank you. And please come back and join us. Our listeners love it, and you know we do too. Dr. Dhople, thank you so much for joining us here in the program.
Amira, Elena, go to school.
I love it. All right. Thank you guys for tuning in. We'll see you next time.